Hello and a very warm welcome to the Internet of Things Made Simple. I'm Larry Wilhumer. This is our 29th mini episode. Many thanks for taking time to join us. Special shout out to any newbie listeners. Great to have you on board. And congrats on taking the first step towards learning more about the Internet of Things. We try to keep it light, you know, a little technical jargon here and there. And we try to use as many real life examples as we can. And maybe try to keep it entertaining a little bit anyways. As always, I ask you to check out our webpage, theinternetofthingsmadesimple.com. Based on our traffic reports, more and more of you are doing so, so keep up the good work. We have links to other previous podcasts. As well, this is the first place I put up podcasts, so if you're kind of that sneak peek kind of person, you may want to check out the webpage. There's also some new blogs posted and some links to some great ebooks. They're very colorful, informative, and interactive. If you do like this podcast, why not have it delivered automatically to your feed by subscribing to it using your favorite podcast service? We post them sometime on Wednesdays. And if that feed allows you to leave comments, kindly do so. In this podcast, we're going to cover a topic that we saw in the news. It's based on an article that spoke about how technology was changing many old school industries. So we decided to put a little bit of a spin on it and focus only on how IoT is changing these industries. I recently saw a great stat that's been credited to futurist Leonie Freeman, who was citing some work from Citi. It shows how long it took different technologies over the past few decades to reach 50 million active users. The numbers are kind of staggering. It took the traditional landline telephone or POTS line 75 years to reach that magical 50 million user mark. It took the radio 38 years and TV 13 years. Fast forward to more recent innovations, and the time to gain that level of traction has gone from quick into hyperdrive. The internet, which took only 4 years, now seems slow when you compare it to Twitter that took 9 months, and that even seems like a dinosaur when you compare it to Pokemon Go from a couple of years ago. That took amazingly only 19 days to reach 50 million subscribers. Take a moment to absorb that if you need. I'll just be quiet for a sec. Okay, now back to the podcast. The business world has been changed by many IoT-enabled technologies over the past few years. Just think for a sec. You know, Uber has changed how we get a cab. Airbnb has changed often how we stay on vacations. Many apps have changed how and where we eat. And, you know, smartphones are changing healthcare by allowing different kinds of scans and other things like that. This means that change can happen in just about any industry. But for the purpose of this podcast, we're going to focus on two, finance and telecommunication. All right, now let's start with finance. If you want to make your kids look at you with the funniest look, just tell them how banking happened in the 1970s and 80s. You probably got paid on a Friday. Maybe you were lucky and got paid on a Thursday and got to avoid some of this rush, but let's just say you got paid on a Friday. Everyone got in their car and drove like a maniac to the bank branch. Stood in line for the longest time and cashed their check on that Friday afternoon. They kind of had to because banks were closed all weekend. There were no bank machines, or at least not in the 70s anyways and into the 80s. There was no Interact, and credit cards were available, but they're much harder to get than they are today. Fast forward to 2019, and it's a fair statement to say that technology has changed finance just about more than any other industry that we use in our day-to-day life. And it's not slowing down anytime soon. Financial technology companies, or fintech for short, are changing how we invest and are using technology to change how we deal with our money. IoT is helping to keep banks relevant in this difficult period. We covered this much more in our ebook on finance, which is available on our webpage, but here are some ideas. IoT sensors allow banks to identify customers upon arrival. Something we'll talk about in a future podcast about how fast food companies are using license plate readers to increase customer loyalty. They do this to allow for a quicker and more personalized service. GPS-enabled tools are doing something that you might find a little creepy. They're allowing the bank to send you timely messages. So imagine you and your spouse or by yourself are looking to buy a new car and you're on the lot and all of a sudden, why did I get a text message from the bank saying that I have a great rate on a new car? It's because they're using the combination of GPS, which is available through many of the bank applications, and they know where all the different dealerships are, so they can use this for more timely offers, and they tend to find a much better pickup when they do this. Speaking of cars, onboard diagnostics allow the banks to better understand driving patterns, which allows them more flexibility in the type of loans and services they may offer for the car. Now, none of us expect banks to go away anytime soon, at least not entirely, but using IoT is helping to keep them much more relevant for much longer. The second area that we're going to talk about is the telecommunications space, something that's a bit more near and dear to my heart. They definitely had some super sweet monopolies for decades,
like long-distance charges
for the home and for the office, expensive dedicated business connections like T1s, and text messaging over the years were all great cash cows for their time. But for the most part, they've all gone away thanks to the internet and different OTT or over-the-top services. You know, think Facebook, iMessage, those kind of things. The same holds true for a cash cow they're fighting to hold on to now, cable television. Again, like the banks, no one is saying the telecom companies are going away anytime soon, but they do need other new sources of revenue, like that from IoT. It probably doesn't surprise you that the cellular carriers are in an obvious position to benefit from the rise of IoT, as they have the most widespread coverage for networks for devices to connect to. But there are three things they need to overcome. The first is upstarts like LoRa and Sigfox that do offer some benefits for networks to customers that make it appealing for many of them to not use traditional cellular networks. This is especially true for municipalities and people with a lot of assets in a certain region. The second point is that, for the first time, using cellular networks might not require the services of a cellular carrier at all, due to the ability of newer technology to be deployed in private networks, say at a mine site or at an educational facility like a college or university. I still imagine the carriers are going to have some play here, as they may offer to put the network in and run it, but it does offer up some space for other people to play in this area. The final point is that the carriers today are often selling identical products, so it becomes more difficult than ever to stand out. If you think about it, if they're all selling 4G network capacity or 5G eventually, and they all have very similar devices, and they're all offering different security services, it does become more difficult to stand out from your competitors. This has definitely hurt their pricing power. Now, having said all this, I don't think they're going away anytime soon, just like the banks. Carriers are going to be around for a long time, but IoT is becoming more and more of an important part of their business. So on a bit of a flip side here, are there industries that are being hurt by IoT? Well, how much time do you have and how many podcasts do you want to listen to? Because that's about all I've spoken about in the last little while is how IoT is changing different businesses. Look at how it's changing the car industry. How much longer will families continue to buy, own, and operate two vehicles that often spend their time sitting in the driveway? Ride-sharing services, increased ability to car share, and even self-driving cars will all shape how we get around in the future. These are all powered by IoT. To their credit, car companies were quick to recognize this, but I'm not sure they fully changed their business in a way to fully benefit from these changes. The same holds true for the energy space. As we change how we drive, how will this affect the demand for oil? Again, to their credit, many energy companies have invested heavily in technologies like solar, wind, and other renewable energies to round out their fossil fuel sales. But can they do it fast enough and in a meaningful enough way to not only save their business, but to help change public perception, which is often against them? For both car companies and energy companies, I have to think they're going to be fine. They are run by some of the smartest people in the business world, but even they have some challenges to overcome, so we'll have to see what happens. If you want to know how IoT may affect your business, drop us a note and we can definitely include it in a future episode. Many thanks for listening to this short podcast. As always, we love to hear from you, good, bad, and ugly. The first place to start is always our Facebook page, The Internet of Things Made Simple, where we also have links to other material. If I'm personally connected to you on LinkedIn, that's a good place to start as well. And if we're connected via old-fashioned ways like email and text, drop me a note that way. Look forward to talking to you soon. Thanks again. Take care. I'm Larry Boy Humor.